Why don't we do this? Why don't we go before the Lord and let's pray? Would you just join with me and let's go before the Lord and let's ask His Holy Spirit to speak to each and every one of us today, would you? Father, we thank You for the opportunity to come into Your house today. Lord, we ask that You would speak to us through Your word, Lord. We don't think of it as just some religious ancient text, but Lord, we acknowledge that it's a live, living word, Father, that speaks to us today right where we're at. So Lord, as we open up Your word, as we open up Your gospels, Father, as we open up Your desire and Your will, Lord, I thank You that You would speak to us right where we're at, Lord, and to open our eyes to see and our minds to be open to what You want for us. And Father, that we thank You that we would walk out of this place equipped and encouraged to be and to do exactly what You've called us to do. And Lord, we thank You for all that You've blessed us with here. Just ask that You would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire today that are meeting and hearing the gospel of Jesus. Pray that You would bless them as You've blessed us. We don't think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but rather we are co-laborers in the body and the kingdom of God, working together to build Your kingdom for Your glory. And so, Lord, to You be the honor and the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we all together said,
amen.
Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles, go with me to Luke in the first chapter, Luke chapter 1. If you got a ribbon in your Bibles, you can go to Luke chapter 1 and then put a ribbon in Matthew chapter 16. Luke chapter 1 is where we're going to read out of this morning. A couple of weeks ago, Stacy and I, we got back from a vacation. We started a new Thanksgiving tradition, kind of like most people in America. It seems like one of the busiest travel days of the year. We started a new tradition where on the Thanksgiving weekend, we kind of try to get out of town and go see some things and just spend some time. So we took our kids, Emma, my daughter, she's 3, and my son Bjorn, he's 5. We took our kids to Zion National Park in Utah, a couple hours away, and we spent a couple of nights there. It was really beautiful. I mean, an amazing place. We had been wanting to go for so many years. We've heard so many wonderful, amazing things about this place, and it was cold. It was like 20 degrees at night, and it snowed on us, and we were camping. I wouldn't really even call it camping. I mean, we bought a small motor home, and so it's like glamping, right? So that's what it really was. But we took our kids, and we had so much fun, but it was work. One of the things that we did is we had this plan. There's this hike in Zion National Park called the Narrows, and there's this river that created these massive canyon walls in this national park called the Virgin River. And you can hike up through the Virgin River into this massive canyon, the Slot Canyon. It's only about 35 feet wide at the most, and the canyon walls go up with several hundred feet, and it's a real famous and real renowned hike to walk up through the river as far as you can go. And so Stacy and I, we're real outdoor enthusiasts, so we just had a plan. We just we're so excited. This is pretty much the reason we drove for 8 hours to go to Zion to take our kids there. And it's really cold. It's chilly out there, so they have you rent this equipment, in the winter months, and it's a dry suit, so you put it on your pants and it keeps you put it on your legs and it keeps you dry, and you wear these special booties to keep your feet warm and special shoes for the river. And so we rented all this equipment. It cost me $154 to rent this equipment. So we had plans. We were just like, we're going as far as we can go. And we took our kids, and Bjorn, he's always loved to go through the rivers. We always take him through. And so we took our kids there, and we have a picture behind of Bjorn, and that's Stacy leading Bjorn through the river. And we went hiking and these massive canyons, and close up on Bjorn's face, I mean, he's just got this biggest smile. I mean, like, this kid is in like total heaven. And so we're just so excited. We're like, this is gonna be great. Well, about 30 seconds later, he felt the temperature of the water go through his little neoprene wetsuit socks, and his feet started going numb. And if you know anything about kids, if anybody got kids, his feet started getting cold and his hands started getting cold. And this is a hike that you could go on for miles and miles and miles. And we made it about 150 feet into this river hike to where we finally had a total family breakdown. I mean, Bjorn was sobbing, crying, done. I'm carrying Emma in a backpack, in a baby backpack. My daughter's 3 years old. She's turning 4 years old this week. She weighs like 40 pounds. I'm carrying like 4 liters of water and all the snacks. I've got like 70 pounds on my back, and Bjorn's crying. He's freaking out. We've made it 150 feet into this little hike, and we're done. I'm walking back. Stacy went up ahead. We had a plan to just leave the kids, and I'd stay with them, and she'd walk, and then she'd come back, and then I'd walk, and she'd come back. But as she was gone, the kids were too cold, the wind was blowing, and they were just getting worse and worse, and things were declining fast. And I was walking with Bjorn back, and I was holding Bjorn, and I had Emma in my backpack, and I'm walking, and this young guy walks by me, and he just goes, man, That's like, you must be like the most amazing dad ever. Like, when I have kids, I want to be just like you. And he walked by and he goes, man, hashtag parenting goals. And I was thinking in my head, I was like, you have no clue. The mean, conniving, hard little things that I said to that four-year-old, you little spoiled brat, I spent $150 on that. I don't care if your feet are cold, you're walking in the river. If you keep crying, I'm gonna take all your toys and throw them in the trash. I've been wanting to do this and you're not gonna ruin it for me. This guy's like, hey, parenting goals. And I'm like, if you only knew the real behind the scenes story. You know, so often what happens is we make these plans and we think they're going to be so great. And something just happens. There's a way of interruption. There's just things that get in the way, and things don't happen the way you thought they would happen, and life didn't pan out the way you thought it would pan out. Your job didn't go the way you thought it would go, or you know, you had financial plans, and then all of a sudden the stock market crashed and interrupted all of those financial and retirement plans. Or, you know, you thought your kids were going to go a certain way and go to a certain college and go to a certain career, and, you know, they just decided somewhere along the line to have a free will and choose not what you wanted for them, but to choose what they wanted. Just things happen all the time that have a tendency to interrupt our plans, our dreams, our desires, and what we want in life. And you know, the thing is about interruptions in life is that it's not something that's uncommon to us as humans. But beyond just interruptions of things that we wanted, there's another type of interruption that I want to talk about today. And I had you turn to Luke in the first chapter. And I want to look at a life of a young girl whose life was interrupted. And Luke in the first chapter, Luke writes this, his gospel account to give us a historical perspective of what happened for the birth and the life of Jesus. And he also writes the book of Acts. And in Luke's gospel account, he writes this story of a young girl whose life was completely interrupted by what God had for her. And so I want to take you there in Luke, the first chapter. Verse number 26, it says, now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The title of this morning, if we're going to think about it, is Life Interrupted. Because right here is the story of a young girl whose life was completely interrupted by God. And see, what Luke has us to say in this gospel account as he starts writing about this young girl, we know her as Mary. Luke says that there was an angel Gabriel who was sent to a town of Galilee, to a village named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man by the name of Joseph, who was of the lineage of David, and this virgin's name was Mary. And what we can see in these short two little scriptures about this young girl, Mary's life, is that Mary was a girl who had a plan in her life. If you think about it like this, Mary was from a very insignificant town. Nazareth is not anything big. Nazareth wasn't situated on the Sea of Galilee where a lot of fishing and a lot of industry was. Right at the time, Tiberias was a city that was starting to grow. It was kind of like the economic hub of the area. Nazareth was on the other side of a hill, kind of out in the sticks, kind of out in the country. I think we can relate a little bit if you think about it like this. When people think of Southern California, they think about the wonderful weather and they think about the sunshine and Hollywood and palm trees. Very rarely do they think about the Inland Empire. Right? Oftentimes when people are here visiting for the church in the first time visitors lounge and they say, you know, oh yeah, I'm just visiting from out of town. Like, one of my first questions is kind of like, what brought you here? But let's take it a step further. It's not even so much, Nazareth isn't even so much like the Inland Empire. Nazareth is this little podunk kind of country town. So Nazareth, if you want to think of it like this, you want to equate it to this, Nazareth is kind of like Beaumont. Now, if you live in Beaumont, hey, there's some nice homes, good price, golf courses, easy commute on the 10 freeway, but there's just not very much out there. And this is kind of the town that Mary lived in. She was just this average girl, a blue-collar girl in a blue-collar town. There wasn't a lot of people there. It's not this metropolitan hub. It's not this center of culture or anything like that. It's just kind of a little village. And yet Gabriel is sent to this girl, Mary. And it tells us that Mary was betrothed to a man by the name of Joseph. Now, betrothal, that's not a word we use very often in our day. So betrothal, if we think of it like this, you could say it like this. Mary was engaged to Joseph. But engagement, we got to understand something. Engagement isn't like what it is today. Now, culturally, marriage was very different than what it 2,000 years ago in Jesus' time as it is today. You think about marriage today and you date somebody, right? You go on Match.com or eHarmony and find your compatible person, right? And you got to try it out and make sure it's the right one. You don't want to mess it up. And so you go through this process of love and butterflies and roses and dating and marriage in Mary's day was different. It was more of a transaction. It was more of an alliance between families. You see, betrothal was a promising. It was a transaction. Mary's family more than likely entered into an agreement with Joseph or Joseph's family, and they had a transaction or agreement of things that would take place because of this relationship or because of this marriage. And so what a betrothal was is she was engaged, but now that she was promised to Joseph, she was legally under Joseph's care or under Joseph's covering. She was basically his wife, even though yet she wasn't his wife. So Mary was a girl, if you think about it like this, Mary was a girl who had plans. She had plans to marry a man by the name of Joseph. She, like every other girl, she found herself a good man with a job. Praise God. Girls looking for a boy, always remember it, looking for the boy with a job first. He don't have a job right now. What makes you think he's going to get one later? I'm just saying. Not only did she find herself with a man with a job, she found herself with a man, a good blue-collar, skilled laborer. I mean, this guy, part of the carpenters' union, got himself a pension. She is ready for it. I mean, you think about it like this. Remember back in the day when they used to say the American dream was like to live in a little tiny home with a white picket fence and have 2.5 kids, whatever a 0.5 kid is, right? That's like perpetual, eternal pregnancy. I don't know who wants to be pregnant forever, but apparently that's the American dream. Mary was entering into the Nazareth dream. She was just an average girl from an average town, marrying an average blue-collar guy, hoping to settle down, have a couple of children, live their life, get through life, you know, not die of some terrible disease. That's what Mary's plan was all about. But don't you know, life has a way of interrupting us. And Mary's story is really the story of a life interrupted. So let's look what it says and goes on and out. It says, on this account, Gabriel says, and he's come in, and the angel says to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." Now you think about this for a moment. Mary, she's in her house. She's out in the garden. She's somewhere, and Gabriel comes to her, and his entrance is, "Rejoice, highly favored one. Blessed are you among women." Now Mary, she's probably been to Sunday school. She was trained. She's like, "Angel Gabriel's here. I got a blessing coming my way. Amen. Something gonna happen in Jesus' name." Okay, well, Jesus wasn't born yet, so she didn't say Jesus' name. But look what it says. Look what it says. This is interesting. It says, when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying. And she wondered what manner of greeting this was. You ever had somebody text you out of the blue? Somebody call you, their number shows up on your caller ID, and you haven't talked to them for like 2 years, and you wonder what manner of greeting this is. What you going to ask me for? You know, you don't have the time to talk to me. Now all of a sudden, you need something, and you're going to call. Mary steps back to the Gabriel, my name's Mary, and I live in Nazareth, and Nazareth is nothing really special. Why are you coming to my house? Why didn't you show up to somebody down in Jerusalem, down in downtown, you know, somebody with a position, somebody who's got a big future? I'm just, what are you doing here out in the sticks, out in the country? I didn't even know you knew this area existed. So she wonders what manner of greeting this is. And the angel says, "Don't be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you'll conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and you'll call his name Jesus. And he will be great, and he'll be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord will give him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Praise God. Now, some of y'all are clapping because we are reading this in hindsight. So think about Mary. She's not reading this in hindsight. She's looking in foresight. So the angel comes and says, blessed are you, Mary, highly favored of the Lord. Oh, you're going to have a boy. You're going to have a baby. And you're going to call his name Jesus. And he's going to be great. He's going to rise to prominence. He's going to be on the throne of his father, David. You remember how Luke wrote there that Joseph was of the lineage of David. He's going to come to his throne of his father, David. He's going to reign over the house of Jacob. He will have a wonderful kingdom. And I think Mary's thinking for a minute, this is my ticket out of the suburbs. She's thinking, hey, I'm going to get myself a studio apartment right over there down in downtown Jerusalem, looking over the temple with the view over the hills. My baby boy is going to be a king. He's going to be royalty. Oh, man, this is awesome. Peace out, country town. I'm gone. So she's thinking like, all right, Joseph and I, we're going to have a baby. It's going to be great when we get married. That baby's going to come. I'm going to have a son. And that's like the best you can do is to have a son, because then that carries on your lineage and he's going to be a king. And then all of a sudden she starts thinking, man, when are Joseph and I going to have that baby? And I can just picture Gabriel's face as she's trying to process this in her head. And Gabriel's just kind of like, no. Mary, I think you're misunderstanding. Not you and Joseph. She's like, what? Look what it says. Look, Mary. I can just imagine Mary scratching her head a little bit, trying to figure this out. Mary says to the angel, how can this be, since I don't know a man? Now, if you got kids that are under 12 in here, what Mary is saying is that Joseph and I have not yet made the appointment for the stork to come in like 9 months. You see, Gabriel, I don't know how it works with angels and all that stuff, because y'all are spiritual beings and eternal. And she's like, but Gabriel, let me explain it to you. Here on earth, there's a process that is involved in a baby. You see, you got to make an appointment. You know what I'm talking about? Okay. Got to make an appointment. She's like, I have not made that appointment yet, right? Because I'm saving myself for marriage and waiting for that special day. I have not known a man. Kids are like, what are you talking about? And then she just doesn't know any guys. That's what she's talking about, right? Right, mom and dad? That's what she's talking about. And Gabriel says, don't be afraid, because you found favor with God. And behold, you'll conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and he shall be great. Or he shall be called, you shall call his name Jesus, and he will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord will give him the throne of his father David. Oh, excuse me, I'm reading the wrong verse. And the angel answered and said to her, verse number 35, the video guys are like, ah. The angel says, she says, how does this happen? Because Joseph and I, we haven't gone through this process yet. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also the Holy One who was to be born will be called the Son of God. So Mary's thinking, Gabriel, so what you're telling me is, I'm going to have a baby, but not with Joseph. And Gabriel's like, yeah. And she's like, and nobody else. Yeah. So how's the Holy Spirit? Okay, so I'm going to have a baby with just me in this process. Yeah, the Holy Spirit will overshadow you. You'll have a son. He'll be the Son of God. Gabriel, this isn't possible Gabriel, ever since the creation of man, I went to Sunday school, I remember the story, God took the dirt and he made Adam and he breathed life into Adam. But ever since Adam, there was a process involved, you know, step A, step B, step C. And so this doesn't work. And Gabriel goes on, he says, listen, your cousin, just to tell you, just as a sign, your cousin who couldn't have any babies is already pregnant with a baby. And he goes on, he says, for with God, nothing is impossible. And you see the story, what Luke is writing here, and Matthew writes about it a little bit in his gospel account as well, is that God's plans will interrupt your plans. You see, Mary was a girl. She had plans. She was marrying a guy, and they were going to have a life together, and everything was going to be good, and everything was going to be easy, and everything was just going to go the way it goes, and you know, it was just going to happen. But all of a sudden, everything changed in an instant. Why? Because now Mary is going to be pregnant without Joseph being the dad. And in our day and age, that's not that big of a deal. There's girls that have had babies all the time without being married or without being in marital relationships. It's a growing problem within our societies, the absence of the father figure within the home. And so to us, we say, well, that's not that big of a deal. But you need to understand, contextually in Mary's world, this was a big deal. As a matter of fact, this was probably one of the biggest deals a young woman could deal with. One of the biggest oopses that you could have in life was this. You see, Moses had written in the law that if a woman was to have a child out of wedlock, if she was to get pregnant outside of marriage, that she was able, literally, legally, they were allowed, her family was allowed to take her out to the streets, to the doorstep of their house and stone her to death. This is the consequence of Mary's pregnancy of Jesus. You think about that for a moment. Mary had plans. Mary was just going to live a life, just an average life in an average town, and just can kind of to live and just to exist. And now all of a sudden, everything she thought her life would be was now different from that moment forward. And God's plans will interrupt our plans. I mean, think about it for a moment. Think about this. So Mary, she goes, and all of a sudden, a couple of weeks later, Mary starts getting nauseous. Family starts asking, people start asking, Mary, you okay? You kind of look a little bit green. You're not doing so good. And she's like, I'm good. A couple of weeks later, Mary starts getting these crazy cravings. People are starting to wonder, like, she's like, I would just kill for a pickle and some goat's milk right now. They didn't have ice cream. So you gotta kind of play with me, all right? So she's like, what I would just do for a pickle and some goat's milk. People are like, Mary, what are you talking about? And all of a sudden, Mary, she kind of starts to gain a little bit of weight, and her friends start to look at her and they say, Mary, you got cankles. What's going on? You okay? You've been putting on a little bit of weight, Mary. Are you all right? And all of a sudden, Mary starts showing. Now there's a bump where there shouldn't be a bump. And she walks out, and one day the wind kind of catches her garment, and Joseph sees this bump. And now all of a sudden, Joseph realizes his fiance is pregnant, and it's not his baby. And in Matthew's account of the gospel, Matthew tells us that Joseph was a good man. Joseph was an upright man, and Joseph didn't want to make a public spectacle of Mary, but he was really seriously considering whether or not he was going to put Mary up. Whether he was going to hand her a certificate of divorce and conclude or cancel this betrothal or this arrangement. You think about it like this, the consequences of even Joseph's divorce to Mary would have been Joseph's. Remember, Mary was under Joseph's covering. Joseph was her financial covering. He was her protective covering. Joseph, by all senses, was her husband, legally speaking, in this arrangement. And if Joseph was to divorce Mary because of this illegitimate pregnancy that he sees, Mary's family, a stand-up or an upright family, would not take the disgrace of bringing Mary back into their home, which means the only option or the logical or the most likely path that a woman in Mary's situation would have been a life of harlotry to support herself. That's what Mary was potentially facing in this moment. But you know, Joseph was considering divorcing Mary, and an angel, Gabriel, came to Joseph in a dream, and he said, Joseph, he said, don't you divorce that girl. Don't you leave that girl, Mary. You marry her, Joseph. You take her as your wife and you raise that boy. You name him Jesus. You raise him as your own. And Joseph woke up and he did that and he followed what Gabriel said. But you think about this. Their life in an instant was turned upside down. Everything that they knew. Now all of a sudden, Joseph has to explain why Mary's pregnant and they're not married yet. Mary has to explain why she's pregnant and they're not married yet. And their life was completely interrupted by God's plan. The question I ask myself is, why Mary? Why Joseph? I mean, okay, so we know that Mary has to have the lineage of David, and Joseph had to have the lineage of David, and so, you know, their bloodlines matched up. But we got to understand geographically what this is. You see, they were in the town of Nazareth. Nazareth, the towns that we live in, they're not like what you and I live in. Like, you don't go to a town because it has affordable housing, or you don't go to a town because they had that new subdivision, and you rode your donkey through, and they had the new homes guide, and you went through a model home, and you said, man, this is a really nice home, and I'm going to upgrade my home, and this new home has, you know, that didn't work that way. The way these towns and these villages were is they started with tribes. They started with people. Most everybody in the town was related. And when you're several hundred years removed from the lineage of somebody, it's very likely that many people within the town of Nazareth had the same lineage, or the same bloodlines, roots back to David that Mary and Joseph would have had as well. As a matter of fact, I think probably, you think about it, there was probably 40 or 50 other girls that were as eligible as Mary to do what Mary had to do. But you see, some reason God chose to interrupt this young girl, probably 15, 16 years old. God chose to interrupt her life. Why? I think the answer comes in the next couple of verses. And it goes on, and his angel tells her about her cousin. He says, well, God, with God, nothing is impossible. Verse number 38 of Luke, the first chapter. Look what Mary says. Mary says, behold, the maidservant of the Lord. I'm at your service. Let it be done to me according to your word. And then Gabriel left. Why Mary? Why Joseph? I believe it was because Mary's heart was ready and prepared to be interrupted by God. And you see, God's not interested in our outward actions. God's not interested in our outward appearance of how likely we might be ready to be interrupted by His plan that interrupts our plan. God wants our hearts to be ready and prepared to be interrupted from our plans, our dreams, our visions, our hopes, our desires for His plan, His dreams, His visions, His hopes, His desire for us. And when our hearts are not ready and prepared for God's interruptions, we end up missing God's plan for our life, and we end up missing God's blessings in His plan. And so why Mary? Because Mary's heart was prepared for God's interruptions in her life. You see, life will present itself with all sorts of interruptions. Traffic on the way home. Commercials in the favorite part of the movie, the phone call during dinner, whatever it might be. But God has specific interruptions in our lives because His plan will interrupt our plans. And Mary says to Gabriel, I am your servant of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word. Even if everybody else is going to pick on me, everybody else is going to mock me, if everybody else is going to think I'm crazy or I'm a liar or scandalous, whatever it might be, I accept the consequences of your interruption and I am ready to do what you want me to do. And her heart was prepared for the interruptions of God. Let's take it a little step further for what Mary had to deal with. Because we look at Mary's story from the end to the beginning. But Mary didn't know that it wasn't just a 9-month journey. So Mary has Jesus and we celebrate Christmas and they're in the manger and the wise men and the shepherds and the star and the sky and all that. Now we think everything's good. Nobody's going to ask any more questions because Joseph's going to raise Jesus as his dad and it's all going to be good. But you know what happens is the Bible tells us, John tells us, that Jesus has brothers, 4 of them that we know of and at least one sister. Joseph and Mary continued to grow their family. And in the course of Jesus' life, John tells us that Jesus' own brothers didn't even believe him, that he was who he said he was. And so all through the course of Mary's life, she had to stand behind, she had to defend, she had to explain to her own family members why Jesus was that special child. Jesus is different. You know, if you have kids, you have that different kid. Imagine Mary's position, explaining why Jesus is different. All through the course of Jesus' life, she's got to stand behind him. And then all of a sudden, Jesus, he's an adult, he's a grown man, he's been trained in the way of his dad, carpentry. And now all of a sudden, Jesus says to mom, I'm moving out. I'm moving to Capernaum and I'm starting my ministry. And Jesus moves out of the house. And now mama gets to watch her boy rise to prominence. And all of a sudden, people start coming from all over the places. And they're watching. She's watching Jesus. And people are flocking to him. And they're coming from everywhere. And Jesus is gaining in popularity. And Mary's all proud. And she's like, that's my boy. That's my baby. And then all of a sudden, everybody leaves him. And all the people that were professing to follow Jesus in an instant, they go away, and his brothers think, man, this guy's out of his mind. And Jesus comes back to his hometown and they're like, isn't this just the carpenter's son? Like, aren't his sisters and his brothers right here with us? And Mary's back to the same place again. And then all of a sudden, Jesus decides to go to Jerusalem. And he has dinner with his followers. And he goes to the garden and he prays, and Mary had to go and she had to watch them take her baby boy, who's now 33 some odd years old. She had to take and watch him get beaten and whipped and chastised by the Roman Praetorium in the guard. And then she had to watch him get dragged back to Pilate's court and to hear the crowd about her son shout out, crucify him, and this is her baby. And then she had to watch her son carry a heavy wooden cross on the streets of Jerusalem to the outskirts of town to be nailed to a cross, to be hung for the public to see, naked, for people to mock and to scorn and to spit on him and to become a spectacle for the world to see. And she had to watch him die. And this is the burden that Mary carried. From the day Gabriel said, I'm going to interrupt your life with God's plan, until the day Jesus was died on that cross, Mary had a burden that she had to carry. And I want to point this out to you. Look what it says once again in Luke, the first chapter, verse number 38. When Mary, in the very beginning, she says, let it be done according to your word. Look what it says. It says, The angel departed. You see, it's really easy for us to come to church and worship is on that level 10. I mean, like I got the Holy Spirit goosebumps on my arms. And the pastor, he's working extra hard trying to inspire. He got the veins popping out of his neck and out of his head. He's preaching real good and I'm amen. And I'm thinking, Holy Spirit, I feel you, God. I feel your presence in here. And I'm going to say yes to you, God, interrupt my life. But then you walk out of church and on Monday, life is what life is. And now all of a sudden, you're all by yourself. Nobody's around. Nobody's supporting. Nobody knows the burden and the call and the interruption that God has for you. Will you, can you say yes to God's interruptions when you're all alone? That's what God is looking for in his people. That's why it's not about the outward actions. That's not why it's not about the cried out to God, use me, here I am, send me. God says when you're all by yourself in the dark of night, when everybody else thinks you're crazy, when you don't even understand the burden that you're going to carry for the rest of your life, will you have the heart to say, God, interrupt my plans with your plans, because what you want for me is what I want for me. That is what God is looking for in his followers. God's plans, church, will interrupt our plans, but if our hearts are not prepared for God's interruptions, we will miss his plan and we will miss his blessings. And so the question is, are you willing to lose what you want to gain what God wants for you? Are you willing to lose what you want to gain what God wants for you. Now listen, I'm not telling you not to dream. I'm not telling you to not make plans. I'm not telling you to not have visions and to not say, man, I hope it goes like this and I think tomorrow is going to look like that. That's not what I'm saying at all. But what I am saying is, are you willing to let your dreams, your visions, your plans, your pride, your will, your children, your finances, your life, are you willing to lose what you want for you in order to gain what God wants for you? Because that's the question that God asks every one of his followers. If you've got your Bibles, go to Matthew chapter 16. Let me show you. Matthew chapter 16 says that Jesus, speaking to his disciples, what are his disciples? His disciples are followers. And Jesus says to those who follow him, which means to you and I today, this is a verse, a word that is alive to us. Not just some ancient writings of an ancient man. This is Jesus now speaking to you and speaking to me. And Jesus in Matthew, the 16th chapter, says to his followers, if anyone desires to follow me, let him deny himself. To give up his promise, his dream, his will, his desires, his plans, his schemes, his plots, his hopes. To deny himself. To take up his cross. And follow me. And he goes on and he says it like this. And he says, because anybody who desires to save their life, he says, you'll lose it. But he says, if anybody loses their life for my sake, they will find it. And you see, what happens by nature, what we do is we grasp on as tightly as we can to what little we can get in life, to the few good memories, to the few high moments and summit experiences, to those few treasured days or seasons in life. And we grasp on as much as we can to the seasons and the times in our lives when our plans actually came to pass. And Jesus says, for those of us who hold on as tightly as we can to what we think our lives should be, he says, the tighter you hold, the more likely to lose. But if you would just be willing to open your life, open your heart, open your will to mine, to lose what you want for you, to gain what I want for you, Jesus says, I promise you, you will find life, you'll find purpose, you'll find existence, you'll find blessing, you'll find destiny, you'll find the reason as to why you are here today. You're not an accident, you're not a mistake, you're not just a mess up of some people. You have a reason, and Jesus just says, if you'd be willing to let go of what you so tightly hold on to, and be willing to lose it for what I want for you, I'll give you life. I'll give you life. You see, the Bible, God's word, is a narrative. It's a story from Genesis to Revelation. It's a story of people whose lives were interrupted by God. Abraham, an old man, ready to retire. In his dad's land, God interrupted him one day and said, Abraham, pick up and move to a place I'll eventually show you. Someday I'll make you a great blessing, but for the rest of your life, you're going to live a nomadic life and wander around. But I tell you what, if you do that, I will bless you. I'll give you an inheritance. I'll give you kids. I'll make you a great nation. You see, Abraham's life was interrupted. A young boy, Bible says, and Samuel was ruddy looking, red hair. He was a ginger like me, sitting on the hills of Judea, watching his sheep, playing his harp. All of a sudden, God said, hey, David, I want to interrupt your life. I want to make you a king over this nation. But there's a giant that needs to be killed, and nobody wants to kill the giant. I need you to go kill the giant, but I'll make you great. You see, there were some fishermen fishing on the side of the Sea of Galilee. James and John and Peter and Andrew gathering their nets. And this Judean carpenter comes by and says, hey, follow me. And they had to leave their nets behind and accept God's interruption for their life. And now all of a sudden, these men changed the world. There was this young Jewish rabbi named Saul. on the road to Damascus, thinking that he's serving God. And then God knocks him off his horse and says, hey, stop persecuting me. Start following me. And Saul says, I thought I was. And he says, I'm Jesus. And now all of a sudden, Saul has to accept God's divine interruption in his life. Doesn't matter what season in life you're in, God's plans will interrupt your plans. And if your heart's not ready and prepared for God's interruptions, you'll miss his plan and you'll miss his blessings. But let me tell you this. If we would just submit our will to God's, it would just be that easy. But it's so hard. Why? Because we have dreams. We have plans. We have hopes. We have desires. I want my life to look like this. I could say in my own life, there were things in which I thought my life was going to look like this. My life was going to go that way. And by this time of my life, I was going to be this, and I was going to have this, and I was going to do this. And yet God said, no, I'm going to interrupt you. I thought, God, this is your plan. And God says, that's not my plan. Let me show you my plan. And in certain areas of my own life, I said, like, Mary, here I am. And in other areas, I said, God, I'm not ready. Interrupt my life, but just not here. Because God's plan, it's not always easy. Let's not sugarcoat it. God's plan's never easy. But it's always worth it. It's always worth it. You see, whenever God's plan interrupts your plan, it's going to involve work. Work, 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 work. It's going to involve work. It's never easy, but it's always worth it in the end. And as we conclude today, I want to take you to one more story, Matthew chapter 19. One more story of a divine interruption. Matthew chapter 19, if you got your Bibles, go there. A young man comes up to Jesus as Jesus is teaching. He says, good rabbi. Jesus says, why do you call me good? There's no good but God. He says, good rabbi, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus says, well, you know, you'd be good to follow the laws and to honor your God and to obey your mama and your daddy, and you'd live a long life and you'd be good. And this rich young guy comes to Jesus and he says, well, I've done all of that since my youth. What am I missing? And this is a moment, so often we talk about this verse in Matthew chapter 19 regarding finances. But this is a moment of divine interruption, of God's interruption in a man's life. In Mark's gospel and in Mark's account of the gospel, Mark says that Jesus looked at him and he loved him. And Matthew says these words, and Jesus says, he recounts what Jesus says, and Jesus says, if you want to be perfect, if you really want a God interruption in your life, he says, go and sell everything that you have and give it to the poor, and come and follow me, and you'll have treasures in heaven. You see, God's plan's not always easy. It's never easy, but it's always worth it. You see, this man had a lot of possessions. This man's identity was tied up in his wealth. And in this story in Matthew, the 19th chapter, tells us in the very next verse that this young man walked away sad and discouraged because he had great possessions. You see, I think this rich young ruler is an image of us in the church in the 21st century world. You see, we're so blessed. We don't even understand how blessed we are. You see, the problems that you and I face on a day-to-day basis are what the rest of the world calls first world problems. First world problems are the toilet seat's cold in the morning. And so because of that, we say, God, interrupt our lives, and we come to church and we raise our hands high and we amen the pastor as loud as we can, and we come on a regular basis and everything on the outside looks like it's right, but yet in our hearts we're saying, what is the one thing we're missing? And Jesus just says, would you be willing to let me interrupt your plans, your dreams, your desires, your hopes, your schemes? Look, I'm not telling you to sell your house. I'm not telling you to take your retirement account and give it to the church. That's what Jesus said to this man in his divine interruption. But simply what I am saying is what Jesus said, is would you allow your heart to be in that place that says, God, I'll let you interrupt me in my comfort. I'll let you interrupt me in my plans and my hopes and my dreams and my desires, because what I want for me is good. But what you want for me is better. See, Paul tells the church at Ephesus, he says, look, the only thing that limits God in your life is your own imagination. He says, God is the one who's to Jesus, who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could even ask or think. You think you've got good plans. God says, I've got great plans, but you've got to be willing in your heart to lose what you want for you, to gain what I want for you, because it's not going to be easy, but I promise you, it's going to be worth it. Jesus knew that this man was tied up in his treasures. Jesus didn't say, get rid of your treasures. He said, get rid of your treasures on earth, and I'll give you treasures that don't go away. I'll give you treasures in heaven. But yet, he was unwilling in his heart to be interrupted by God. And he missed God's plan, and he missed God's blessing. You see, Mary was just a girl, an average girl from an average town. Not much of a future in store for her, but Mary, her heart was willing to be interrupted by God. And ultimately, Mary is the most endeared woman on the face of the earth. There are more people who know who Mary is, sorry for those of you who voted for her, than Hillary Clinton, or than Rosa Parks, or than any other significant woman in history. So when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and said, Mary, you're blessed. Mary, you're favored among women. Mary, you are highly favored of God. He wasn't messing around. He knew the end result. Mary didn't yet know it, but her heart was willing to be interrupted by God. And she was willing to submit her will, her plans, her pride, her dreams, her desires to what God wanted for her. So now when Peter writes about you and he writes about me and he says, you are blessed, you are a peculiar people to the world, you are highly favored of God, you are a royal priesthood, you got some royalty in your DNA, and I got plans for you. Just like Gabriel said to Mary, Peter wasn't joking, Paul wasn't joking. God's not messing around when he says, you will be my friend, but it's gonna take a heart that's willing to say, God, I got dreams and I think my dreams are good, but if you want something other than my dreams, I will submit my dreams to your dreams, because I'm willing to lose what I want for me to gain what you want for me. And that is a life God is calling every person who follows him to live. A life interrupted for his plan. Will you do it? That is the question God asks every believer on earth. Today, there are some of you in this place that perhaps you need a God interruption right now. Maybe during this message, something was stirring on the inside of you. You just said, man, I don't know. I feel like there's something going on right now. Maybe I've been stuck to my plans too much. Maybe I've been holding on too much. And there are some of you in this place that you think, like that rich young ruler, you know what, I'm good. Everything I do is good. And I feel like God's able to do something in my life, but God looks at you and he says, you don't see what I see. You see what you see, but what I see is a heart not ready. I want to just ask you this question today. Where do you stand with God? Where is your position with him? You know, Paul writes to the Corinthian church and he says, listen, if you guys would just judge yourselves every once in a while, if you just examine your heart, examine your life, he says, you'd not be judged. You'd look into your life and you'd be honest with yourself. And I just want you to take a quick moment, just be honest with yourself. Where are you with God? You can ask the question like this, if you were to leave and to die today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You see, how you arrive at that answer has a lot to say about where you are with God and how you stand with God. And so often, what we think is, I want to go to heaven. I want to be right with God. I hope I'm right with God. I think I am. I don't know. But did you know that nowhere in God's own words does it say that you can hope, that you can think, that you can want, that you can desire, that you can have the most positive outlook on life, and that makes you okay with him, and that makes everything good between you and him? Well, but I always went to church. My parents baptized me as a baby. I was christened, or I went to Sunday school or catechism classes. I always just thought that that meant that I was good between God. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents baptized you or christened you as a baby, because you went to Sunday school or catechism classes, because you've attended churches on a somewhat regular basis, that means that everything's good with, between you and God? Well, I always just thought people who go to church go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? But, you know, I've got a card in my wallet that says I'm a member, and that I've served in church. I've given parts of my life to other people. You know, I worked in the children's ministry before. I've worked with the youth and the troubled youth, or I've sang in a choir. I was ushering at a church. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you are involved, because you serve, because you have a card in your wallet, because you've carried the pastor's Bible, that that makes everything good between you and God? Well, but I always just thought because I'm a good person, you know, I try to stand for social justice and I try to stand for human rights. And, you know, I just always figured if I was good and I'd be good and I'd do good, then it's all good between me and God. But did you know that nowhere in God's own words does it say that your outward actions, that your good deeds are good enough to get you into a right standing and a right position with God? You see, so often what we do is we try to focus on what we can see, the outward actions. But God says, I'm not looking at what you're doing on the outside, like that rich young ruler. Everything looks good. I've done everything from my youth, Jesus. And he says, there's something inside of you that's missing. You see, the Bible tells us, Paul says in Romans, that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody had to teach you how to lie growing up. Nobody had to teach you how to cheat on that test in school at one time. Nobody had to teach you how to stretch the truth at the job. You figured that out on your own. You see, because each and every one of us, all of humanity, was born into a sin nature, a nature that is in apprehension of God, is in opposition to God. And so there's this gap, there's this chasm, there's this unattainable position that we, on our own, cannot achieve. We can't work for it. You can't deserve it. You can't buy it. You couldn't earn it. But Paul says that God gave us a gift through his grace, Jesus, his only begotten Son, John says, who died on a cross for our sin and our shame, so that through a relationship with Jesus, we could now bridge the gap of sin and be reunited and reconnected to God. The Bible describes us in the book of Ephesians as outsiders, window shoppers looking in. But Jesus came that we would not be outsiders, but that we would be insiders. As a matter of fact, in Jesus' own words, he says to a religious man, in order to inherit, what is an inheritance? It's somebody, something for somebody on the inside. And Jesus says, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, eternal life, he says, you must be born again. What does that mean, born again? We think of a society and culture's made that out to be that weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. I'm not so sure I want to do that. Listen, that's not what society and culture's made it out to be, but from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word, it's always meant the same thing in the heart and in the eyes of God. It means that you've given him all of your heart, you've given him all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ, who paid the price on the cross. See, God's not after your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who he is. He's not after the fact that you might know who Jesus is or what Jesus said. You see, he says, I want you to know me intimately and personally. I sent Jesus, God says, to die on a cross for you so that you could have a relationship with me personally, not just religiously. In the book of Revelation, John's recounting what Jesus says to a church. And in Jesus' word, Jesus speaks to this church and he says, I know what you're doing. I know your works. And he says, I'm going to return. And when I return, he says, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. And what he's saying is that, listen, I'd rather see that you're standing for something than nothing. Because if you're living in the middle, somewhere in the middle, not wholehearted for God, not wholehearted against God, kind of doing your own thing, occasional church attendance, token prayer, got a cross or a crucifix around your neck, but you're not wholeheartedly serving God. He says, you're not going to make it. And I love you enough and I respect you enough today to tell you the truth and to challenge you even. God, forgive us in American churches that we've watered the message down because we've been more interested in the numbers of people in chairs rather than the condition of the soul. But Jesus says, listen, you're not going to make it on a half-hearted commitment. You're not going to make it with a sense of religion. You're not going to make it with a token church attendance every once in a while. You see, God gave what was most valuable to him, his Son, for us. And in return, he wants what's most valuable to us, our lives, our hearts, in return. And Jesus says, listen, it's not even so much what happens when you die. That's important. But Jesus says, I've come to give you life today, that you would have life more abundantly. Many of you have been living your life, doing your own things, trying to fill the hole in the void on the inside of you with friends, with relationships, with titles, with possessions, with materials, with Facebook likes, whatever it might be, only to find out that no matter how hard you try, there's an emptiness on the inside of you that you can't seem to fill. And today, simply put, I want to offer to you the invitation to receive salvation with Jesus Christ today. You see, Jesus says to that same church, he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and I knock." He says, "If you just open the door, I'd come in and we'd have a relationship together." I believe the Holy Spirit right now is knocking on the door of your heart, saying it's time for you to stop trying to do things your way. Asking you, would you just submit what you want to what I want for you? Because what I want for you is better than what you could want for you. The decision's yours. You see, the Bible tells us the gift of God is eternal salvation. Now all you and I have to do is to receive that gift by accepting Jesus into our lives as our Lord and as our Savior. And today I want to give you that opportunity. In just a moment, here's what I'm going to do. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three and I'll clap my hands. I'll go like this. I'll go 1, 2, and on the count of three, I'll go 3. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. I'll ask you to do something. I'm asking you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand today is you're saying, you know what, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. You see, what we're going to do in just a moment is we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. You want to invite Jesus into your heart, invite Jesus into your life. You want to make a change in your life today for Jesus. What you're doing by raising your hand, you're saying, you know what, that's me. You're talking to me today, and I want to make that decision. Jesus said these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'd confess you before his Father. But if you deny him, he says, I'll deny you before my Father. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way. And he's already done everything he could by giving Jesus his most valuable possession for you and I, so that we could be reconnected with him, leave our past, our sin, and our shame behind, and have salvation through Jesus and a relationship with him. But it starts today by accepting, by acknowledging that today. I'm going to ask you to do something real quick. Would you do this for me? Would you just take a quick moment? Would you just close your eyes? Would you just bow your head just for a moment? Not because you're embarrassed or because we're ashamed, but I just want you to take a moment and shut out all the distractions that you might be looking at. Stop thinking about what you're going to eat for lunch or what you're going to do for Christmas vacation. And just take a moment right now and let it be you and God. When you close your eyes, there's nobody left standing but you and God. And as you look into your heart and as you look into your life, is that you I'm talking to today? Not sure, unsure, never giving your heart, never giving your life to Jesus Christ. In just a moment, as your eyes are closed and your head's bowed, if that's you in this place, in a moment, I'm going to count to three. And all you simply got to do when I clap my hands is you put your hand up and I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it. And shortly after that, I'm going to invite you up here to shake my hand and I want to pray with you a personal prayer of salvation together. And what you're doing right now is you're saying, that's me. Pastor Luke, I want to give my life to Jesus. I'm tired of living for me. All across this auditorium, I'm going to count to three. If that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. This is your moment. This is your time. You've had dentists and doctor's appointments. Now it's a divine appointment between you and God. Your life is about to change right now, and you can feel God knocking on your heart. You ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands in this place today. If that's you, I see you, my friend. If that's you in this place, I see those hands. I see that hand over there. If that's you, you pop your hand up so I can see you. I see you over here. I see you guys over there in the back. Anybody else in this place today saying, man, I wonder if I should. If you should, yeah, that's you. Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. Say, man, that's me. I see that hand back there. I see that hand back there in the back. If that's you in this place today, I got you, my man. Your hands raised high and proud. Good for you. I see you back there in the back. All over this place, hands are going up, making a commitment for Jesus. If that's you saying, I want to do that today, I see you back there in the back. Anybody else in this place today, I see you. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Lots of people's commitment. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to wrap it up. And I'm going to pray that prayer. I told you I want to shake your hand and I told you I want to pray with you. Now here's what we're going to do. I don't want to embarrass you. I don't want to call you out. But here's what I want to do. I want to shake your hand. I want to congratulate you. And I want to pray with you. So here's what I'm going to ask. In just a moment, my friend Elijah is going to sing a song. And as he does, I want to ask everybody to stand. And if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you know that's you. And you want to pray that prayer together today. I want to ask you to do something. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you've got family members, say, come on with me. Or if they raise their hand, say, come on, I'll go with you. Let's all go together. And I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar, because we're going to change destinies together. We're going to pray together right here. So let's all stand. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, come and meet me right here. We're going to pray and change destinies together right here, right now. This is your moment today.
I need you, Lord, I need you. And every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need
you. And that's you. This is your moment. God, hey, you guys came. And listen, you might have a life full of mistakes and bad choices, but let me be the first person today to tell you, good job. Good job. Doing a good job. Making the best decision you can make. Good job. Today we're going to pray a prayer. Listen, God doesn't listen just to the words of your mouth like you say some abracadabra magical formula and everything changes. God listens to the prayers of your heart. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer. And it's not about repeating some formula, but rather I want you just to believe in your heart what you're saying. So think about it as you say it and believe it in your heart and use your mouth to speak it out loud to God. And we're going to go before the Lord and we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. And I'm going to ask everybody in this place to pray together with me. So let's all join together. If you're watching at home online and you want to pray this prayer, maybe you raised your hand because there's some of you in this place that you raised your hand, but you didn't come. You can pray this prayer right now. Let's all bow our heads together and let's all join. And you guys up here especially, but everybody, would you repeat these words after me and let's go before the Lord today. Repeat these words. Say, Father God, I come today and I acknowledge that I need you. Today, I commit my life. I commit my heart to Jesus Christ. I ask that you'd forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me of my past. Lead me in my future. Today, I make the proclamation. I'm going to follow Jesus with all of my heart, with all of my life. Fill me today with your Holy Spirit. From this day forward, I'm a Christian. I'm headed for heaven, leaving hell behind. I am saved in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, just like that. Just like that. Real quickly, here's what I want to do. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a real cool guy. He wants to take you guys right over there. Listen, I promise nothing weird goes on. It's not like that. He's just going to introduce somebody that will pray with you if you need some prayer, a friend that will connect with you, that will meet with you here at the church to teach you some things about the Word of God. For just a couple of weeks, they'll buy a cup of coffee. If anything else, get some free coffee, all right? Come and get some, hear some Word of God, and they'll teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in what God has. And lastly, he wants to put some information in your hands. We don't want you to leave this place empty-handed, walking out of here saying, what do I do next? We're going to help point you in the right direction. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over with my friend, Pastor Joel. Congratulations. Praise God.